But now going to Discovery Park. They need to be here at the church by 9:15. And the parents need to be back to pick them up around 4:30. If there's any children 6 years of age and under, they ask that their parents go with them. And if you are going and haven't filled out a permission slip, there's still some up back there. We ask that you do this. The youth camp went very well. We'll hear from them tonight. So let's remember this. We've got several prayer requests. Thank you so much for your prayers. Past week and a half has been a trying one. I've lost two cousins and a nephew. And my daughter-in-law, her dad is on a vent. They're going to pull the vent in the morning, and it's likely that we'll lose him tomorrow. So I ask you to be much in prayer for my daughter-in-law. Also, be in prayer for the Gail Britt family. I was told that Gail passed away about 2:30 this morning. So let's remember his family. Remember Bobby Brown. Bobby had a stroke and he's not doing well. Continue to remember Frankie Redden family. Bobby Perham, I don't think, Johnny's not here this morning, but I don't think Bobby's doing very well either, is he, Gail? Need to continue to remember him. And the list just goes on and on and on. And we want to just always pray for our prayer list. And especially, it just seems like there's been so many people already in the past month and a half that's lost loved ones again. I have never in my life, and somebody told me that, tells you you're getting old. Well, Mickey tells me that all the time, but I don't pay attention to him. But it's unreal. I've been to the funeral home. Funerals are funeral homes since September of 2019, somewhere between 80 and 90 times. And I've never done that before in my life. So let's pray for all these people that their hearts can be mended. I know from my own experience it's tough. It's one of the toughest things you'll ever face in your life. But with God's help, nothing's impossible. Any other announcements or prayer requests? Yeah, he's on there. I think he's on there too. And that's why it goes back so many pages that's why I ask people to just pray for this list, because I can't keep up with all of them. And I hate to leave people out, but I don't mean to, but God knows who they are. He knows their needs. And I also ask that you always remember Brother Mickey, not only him, all the surrounding churches as they're preaching their hearts out. And let's pray that they can continue to do this and continue to stand on God's word and bring it to us the way it needs to be brought. And if it hurts your feelings or steps on your toes, might have picked your Bible up and look at it. It might have been for a reason. Because I know in Brother Mickey's case, I've seen him hurt because he had preached a certain message, but God told him to do it. So, people, we need to be thankful that we've got a pastor that will do what God tells him to.
Amen.
And that's a lost art in a lot of churches today, and I feel sorry for them. I really do, because we need to hear God's word like we've never heard it before. Anything else? Yes.
Hi, Brother Cook.
passed away during COVID in 2000, and we're having his memorial this coming weekend. He was mentally ill. There's a lot of them around in his family, so just pray for that family. His name was Joseph.
Okay. Any others? Your uncle?
Yeah, it's my mom's brother.
What'd you say his name was?
Michael O'Brien.
Good afternoon, Terry. What? For us coffee drinkers, Terry is always the afternoon shift. And I come in the other morning and he was sitting there and I almost fell out. I don't know what happened, but he was there early that day. Anyone else? Yes. Anybody else? Brother Floyd, do you lead us in prayer, please?
Heavenly Father, Lord, we just love you. We thank you and we praise you, Father. Lord, I lift up, Father, all these prayer requests, Lord, as I'm sitting here. Lord, Father, as one name after another is mentioned, Lord, many that's been on the prayer request list for such time, Father. Lord, new ones, Father, that I haven't heard, Lord. Lord, you know all these circumstances, Father. Lord, I just lift up this Logan to you, Father. Lord, as this lady asked me to pray for him. Lord, you know his circumstance, Father. Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you would move in these lives, Father. Lord, you know what they need, Father. Lord, you know their spiritual condition, Father. Raise them up, Lord. Father, I just lift up this service this morning, Father. Lord, there's many of us here, Lord, that, Lord, we need a touch from you, Father. Lord, you know our conditions. You know our spiritual conditions, Father. Lord, you know our physical conditions, Father. Lord, you know the state of our country, Lord. Father, I lift our country up to you. I lift the leaders up to you, Father. Lord, I lift this movement up to you, Father. Lord, it's very concerning to me and many others, Lord. Father, how we're seeing that this country's trying to remove you out of it. Lord, has almost done so. I just pray, Father, that you pour your spirit out upon us, Father. Lord, that you'd give us an opportunity to turn back towards you, Father. Lord, I just ask that you would condition hearts for the message today, Father. Lord, I just pray if there be one here that doesn't know you, Lord, that you give them an opportunity to, Lord, get it right, Father. If there be one here that needs to draw closer to you, Father, if there be one here that needs to repent, Father, Lord, I just ask that you would give us that opportunity. Lord, we'll be found always giving you all the honor and glory and praise. In Jesus' name, pray Jesus.
Good evening, church.
Amen.
Good to see all of you this morning. I just wonder if there'd be anybody out there this morning that maybe chains broken today. And I just happen to know somebody in the business. So don't. Don't hold out now. You feel free to come. Just come as you are. He don't care what you're wearing, what you look like, whatever. None of that matters. All
Amen.
You got to do is be willing to come. That's all that he is.
Right.
All right. We're going to start out with a little chain breaker this morning. There's a better life. There's a better life. Cause you got a pain. He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, say it. He's a prince, shaky savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light, day and dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain. He's a pain taker.
Sing your song about him. What? day when my strength is failing. The end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before.
SpongeBob Cross, isn't that good? I like that. I cherish things like that because these youth, they grow up so fast. I've got mementos like that from years past that I still keep. I cherish things like that because it reminds me of where they were in that part of their life and how they were learning about Christ, and that's so important. I thank God for that. Wednesday night. How many was here Wednesday night? We had several. Y'all, I encourage y'all to come on Wednesday night. We have a good time on Wednesday night. I had the opportunity to do a baptism on Wednesday night. I didn't tell you about it, but that's okay. We did it anyway. And I baptized Mr. Joe Don House Wednesday night. They even put your name on it, Joe. I told Joe to get him a Bible, a good study Bible. I'm so proud of Joe. Joe gave me his testimony right back there in that little room before I baptized him there Wednesday night. That's what it's all about, folks.
Amen.
Coming to Christ. And he had already done that, showing the world that he's not the old Joe Don. Joe, I don't know about you, but I'm glad today that the world don't know me as who I used to be. Because Joe knew me as I used to be, and it wasn't a pretty picture. But I thank God for that. Thank God for our youth camp this week as they came through. I did a wedding last night. Larry Imus and Cheryl got married last night at 6:30. They were here last Sunday morning. And I don't know if they're, I guess they're on their honeymoon. I don't know where they're at. But we had a beautiful outdoor wedding last night. at 6:30. So y'all pray for Larry and Cheryl as they embark on their journey together in life. Pray that God will be the center of their life in all that they do. So today, we're just thankful to be here today. You know, I don't know about y'all, but I look forward to Sunday morning. I really do. Troy and I actually just got out of jail. We were in service this morning. We had a 9 o'clock service in the lockdown jail this morning. They finally let us in. And we had a good time there this morning, worshiping with those guys there. And by the way, one of those guys that's there, and I'm sure he won't mind mentioning his name, y'all need to pray for him. Jim Smith. Jim's there. And his wife, they brought, I think they have 4 beautiful children. We need to minister to that family, those kids, and see if we can get her back in church and Jeb also. I think he's just looking at some misdemeanor stuff. But anyway, he asked us to pray for him as a church. He's been here lots of times. So remember Jeb. All right. If no other word, we'll see you. Yes.
I forgot to mention Terry Jackson. He has spelled at an auction deficit.
Yes.
And I haven't heard any difference, but I guess he's still in the auction. Last I heard last night, he was still in the auction.
Okay. All right, let's remember him. Also, Robert mentioned a while ago the death of Gail Britt. Some of you may not know Gail. Gail was our song leader at my home church for 20 years, probably. A great, great man of God. He went on to be with the Lord this morning about 2 o'clock. So, all right, let's receive the offering this morning. We got anybody to take that offering? Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful this morning to be able to be here in your presence. Lord, I just pray that you'd fill this place today with your spirit. God, you'd move in this service. God, as we bring your word forth, God, I pray that you'd speak to hearts and change lives forever. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'll pray for all the churches around us as this other variant of the COVID moves around a lot of places, and I pray that it doesn't hit us. Are experiencing a lot of cases, and in some cases it's shutting things down. So we've already been through that. I don't want to go through it again. So just pray. Looking forward to another couple. They're here this morning. They're getting married in about 2 weeks. Adam and Dakota over here. Raise your hand, Adam. Oh, okay, good. Good. Take up 2 offerings. You don't give enough the first time, so we send it back around. No, I'm just kidding. We do a change offering right after this. We've done this for 15 years. And God has really blessed the change offering. We use that change offering to help kids that may not have a Christmas. God has really used that, and I pray that God will do the same. Let's pray once again. Father, again, we thank you and we love you. Lord, I pray that you'd bless this change offering, God, as it goes forward. God, that you would use it to reach the hearts of young men and women. Father, I thank you for what you're doing in this offering. Continue to bless it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yeah, go ahead. Dakota's passing out the wedding invitations for their wedding on the 13th of August at 6:30 here at church. Going back to the doctor this week. If he's all clean, it'll be the third time in a row. They'll probably not recommend any more treatments. He's free from the doctor, I hope. And pray that God'll bless that. He can get back on the road and start preaching the gospel wherever God sends him. Also, on a praise report, Miss Isabel. Y'all know who I'm talking about? That'd be Rhonda's daughter. Just came to me a while ago and said Troy preached last night, and she realized she was lost, and she got saved last night in that service.
Sing special this morning. We're going to do Just As I Am, I Come Broken.
Well,
Y'all look good in the dark.
Oh, thanks.
That's what they always told me. Get them mixed up. I was in Hannibal, Missouri. Everybody ever been to Hannibal, Missouri?
Yeah.
Was taking a tour. Matter of fact, it was a weird tour. They had a team of mules hooked up to a wagon, and they took us up the side of a hill in that wagon. And they stopped at the cave of Tom Sawyer and Huck Finn. Anybody heard that name? And we went into that cave about a quarter of a mile back into the cave. And when we got back there, they asked us this question. Have you ever been in a cave where there was no light? And of course, everybody raised their hand. No, we haven't. And so they doused the lights in the cave. Has anybody ever been there? You cannot see your hand in front of your face. It was so dark. I was in a cave in Sweetwater, Tennessee. Sweetwater, Tennessee, by the way, has the largest underground lake in the world. You go in there, they put you in a glass bottom. They don't turn the lights out, but they put you in a glass bottom boat. And you go out into this lake, and they feed the big trout out of that glass bottom boat in Sweetwater, Tennessee. I never knew it was there. I saw a sign passing through there one time, Patty and I. And it seemed like for several years there, we visited a lot of caves. As a matter of fact, my kids, as they got on up to 10, 12, 13, 14 years old, every time we passed a cave, they would groan because they knew that I was going to stop. They got tired of caves. So it is with our lives. We get tired of being in dark places, don't we? And so today, I'm going to read you a story. Actually, he penned it in several different ways, but in different places. Psalms 57 is about David in a cave. Psalms 142, what I'm going to read, is about David in a cave. And 1 Samuel 22 talks about the cave. But turn with me in your Bibles today to Psalms 142. I'll just read that scripture and I'll back up and I'll give you the history on the other. Psalms 142. My heading on that particular scripture says, "Thou art my refuge." A Mishael of David, a prayer when he was in the cave. I cried unto the Lord with my voice. With my voice unto the Lord did I make my supplication. I poured out my complaint before him. I showed before him my trouble. When my spirit was overwhelmed within me, then thou knewest my path. In the way wherein I walked have they privily laid a snare for me. I looked on my right hand, and behold, there was no man that would know me. Refuge failed me. No man cared for my soul. I cried unto thee, O Lord. I said, thou art my refuge and my portion in the land of the living. Attend unto my cry, for I am brought very low. Deliver me from my persecutors, for they are stronger than I. Bring my soul out of prison, that I may praise thy name. The righteous shall compass me about, for thou shalt deal bountifully with me. Lord, today, I pray that as we look at the writings of David and the place that he was at in a particular time in his life, Lord, most of us have been to that place, a deep, dark place in our life that we don't even like to talk about. But, oh God, you came, became our refuge, and it was such a wonderful transaction, Lord, in the way that you came to us in our cave. You sent us more affliction to rid affliction. God, it's just amazing. Lord, I pray that today would be no different. If there's one here this morning that is in a deep, dark place in their life, Lord, I pray that a ray of light and hope would shine in their hearts today. They would see that they can come out of that cave and come out of it serving in the Lord's army. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. David found himself in 1 Samuel chapter 22. He found himself running for his life. He was running from King Saul. King Saul started out, he was the first king of Israel. And he started out as a godly king. He was anointed of God. He was God's anointed man. And he was leading the nation of Israel. But David came on the scene, and Saul began to lose confidence in himself. And the Bible says that God put an evil spirit in Saul. And Saul, from the time he heard the song, Saul has killed his thousands, and David has killed his 10,000s. He became jealous of David, who had already been anointed to be king of Israel. And he began to seek his life. He threw javelins at him twice, trying to kill him. And David had to flee for his life. And in 1 Samuel chapter 22, we find that David, he went down in chapter 21, rather. It says, David rose and fled that day for fear of Saul and went to Achish, the king of Gath, down in the Philistine country. And David was there, and the Philistines didn't like him any better than Saul did. But David had to fake being crazy before the Philistines. Well, for some of us, that probably wouldn't be too hard.
Amen.
Amen. But he faked a madness. And the kings of Achish said, well, why have you sent me a madman? I don't want nothing to do with this man. I can't do nothing for him. Send him on his way. And so he got out of there, the Philistines, and went down to the land of Moab, and he comes to the cave called Adullam. A cave called Adullam. Now, it's one thing to be unloved and feel like that you're unworthy of anybody's love. And I've seen people like that. This morning, as a matter of fact, Troy and I were conducting that service, and we were preaching the Word of God, and we had, I don't know, Troy, what did we have, 8 guys in there, 10 guys, I don't know what we had, and I preached the old message of Mephibosheth, who was down in a place of cribbles, in a place called Lodabar. Some of y'all are familiar with that story, and I saw the brokenness on those men's hearts and lives and faces as they faced me. And I brought that story forth that they didn't belong there. They were a child of God, and they were a creation of God, and they had no business being in a place like that. And after it was all said and done, I think we had four or five or six raise their hand and said, yes, I prayed to receive Jesus this morning. And I pray they did. I didn't have time to counsel with all of them, but I'll be talking to them, and Troy will, in the future. But sometimes we get in a place in our life where we feel like we can't hear or see God. Now, if you were in a cave like David, David ran to the cave of Adullam. Now, what David did right off the bat was when you get in a cave, you lose light. Caves are dark, folks. And there's no light in the cave. And if you don't have the light in you when you go in the cave, you're in trouble because you're in complete darkness. And you can't see the world around you. You can't see the hand of God moving in your favor. You can't see Satan as he's coming to get you. You can't see anything. You lose sight of all the things that you hold true, and you're in a cave, a dark place in your life, and truth is always there and it's always present. But yet sometimes we get distorted in the darkness. Yeah. We get moved in the darkness, in the dark place in our life where we don't think that we can get out of the cave. Once we go in there, once we choose to enter into that dark place, it seems like the whole world, the weight of the world, is on us. And no doubt that's the way David felt. He felt that the whole world, when he wrote that psalm in 142, it said that no man cared for my soul. Is that what it said? Has anybody here this morning ever felt that way? That no man cared for my soul, not even to give me a morsel of bread or a cool drink of water. Jesus said, if you have fed the hungry, if you visit those in jail, if you visit the sick, and you take care of the little children, you've done it to the least of them, you've done it to me. But sometimes when we get in that position in life, we feel that nobody cares for our soul. This young man that I talked about in Sunday school this morning has lived his life. Little Joe Golder, you remember Joe? He came and sat right there where Greg sat. Little Joe grew up in this church. He turned to the world of drugs. Little Joe, from the time he was 10 years old. He spent most of his teenage years in McCracken County Juvenile Center, back and forth across the state. My grandson spent time there with him in McCracken. And he said Joe was really distorted. He was in a dark place. But I heard Joe's testimony last night, how that God had brought him out of darkness, out of his cave, and given him salvation, and given him a beautiful life, a beautiful wife, and a young baby, and now he's facing 6 years in prison. His baby will be 6 years old when he gets out. But yet he's out of the cave. Seemingly, he's going back in the cave. But see, what you need to know this morning, when you get to the cave, and you think that nobody cares about you, and you cry out to God. Didn't David in 142 in that psalm, didn't he say, I cry unto the Lord?
Yeah.
Well, he cried out to the Lord. And this was talking because he knew what he was talking about. He had been in the cave of Adullam. In Psalms 47 or 57, you read that. He's talking about the same scenario, the same cave. But when he cried out to the Lord, in the deepest, darkest place he had ever been in his life, you know what God did? First of all, God spoke to his family. You read it, it's right there in Scripture. It said when they heard that David had gone into hiding in the cave of Adullam, his mother, his father, and all his brethren came down to the cave where he was at. Now, mind you, They didn't say, well, you got yourself there, just stay there and rot.
Come on.
That's what the modern family says today. You committed the crime, you do the time.
Right.
That's what they say. But I ain't going to come down there and help you. I ain't going to bail you out. I'm not going to. You're in the cave. You got yourself there. You made your bed, lie. That's what people say. You've heard them. David's family came down to the cave where he was at. Not only did he come to the cave, but David is sitting, picture this with me. David is sitting in the cave and thinking, oh God, what am I going to do? God, you're my refuge. You're my strength. And God, I don't feel real strong right now because the whole world is against me. Not one man cares for my soul. God, what am I going to do? And all of a sudden, he looks up at the mouth of the cave and there's a head peeking around and saying, can I come in? Who is it? It's your daddy. He said, yeah, you might as well come on in. I ain't going to be much company to you, but you might as well come on in. And his daddy come in. Then his mama sticks her head around the corner, says, can I come in? And he says, yeah, we might as well make this a family affair. Just go ahead and come in. I'm in trouble, and y'all going to get in trouble for coming down here where I'm at, but go ahead and come in. And then all his brothers and his sisters show up at the mouth of the cave, and David, in his sorrow, in his disappointment, in his heartache, you know he had to be overjoyed to see their faces coming down to his rescue. David didn't do that. God did that. He sent those people down there to minister to David's heart because he knew that David needed a friend. But David, when he saw them coming, oh, I had the blessing to know that somebody cared for his son. Ladies and gentlemen, I've talked to men and women in the prisons that have told me, and not only the prisons, but I've talked to people, listen to me, I've talked to men and women in rest homes that have said, preacher, my family hadn't been here in 10 years. I've been sitting in this room for 5 years, 8 years, 10 years, and nobody has come to. I'm so glad, preacher, that you come by. I just need somebody to talk to. Oh, preacher, would you pray with me? I hadn't had anybody to pray with me in 5 or 10 years. Oh, don't you know that their heart is overjoyed when somebody lets them know that they care for their soul? David's family came to the cave where he was at. They did not come to condemn him. You see, he hadn't been down that road with Bathsheba yet. It was coming. The heartache was coming. But he was being oppressed by the people that sought his life. He was on death row in a cave, ladies and gentlemen, is where he was. And his family cared enough about him to come down to see if they could help him in any way. And so his whole family is gathered together, but that was good. David has been afflicted. He's being oppressed. He's being sought. He's got a wanted poster. They're seeking his life. They're wanting to kill David. So who does God send? He sends his family, and that's good. But who did he send beside his family? Isn't this odd that God would send the ones that he sent? Look at that verse down there in chapter 22, the second verse, I think it is. Look at that. And everyone that was in distress, and everyone that was in debt, and everyone that was discontented gathered themselves unto him. God began to send people that were in distress. What does distress mean? That means that everything in their life is turned upside down. They ain't got no direction in their life. They ain't got no hope for the future. They have nothing to hold on to. They're distressed about life in general, and they're looking for somebody to hold their hand. They're looking for somebody that'll give them direction in their life. So God sends the distressed down to the cave of Adullam. Why? Because he knew that David, even though he was in the cave, even though they were seeking to kill him, God knew that David's heart was right with him. And there was something in that cave for the distressed people that God would put in his life. Isn't it odd that God would send people with afflictions just like David in order to comfort him? You say, well, that is odd. Because that's what God did for me. God had me. I was in the cave, and God sent me some of the God-awfulest people that I'd ever met. They come from jails. They came from prisons. They came from families that had been torn apart. They came from people that had been abused. They came from all walks of life in order to encourage me. I'm telling you this morning that I was in the cave, and God sent those that were in distress to minister to this old boy. He did it for David, and he did it for me. It said, those were in distress came and looked in the cave. Said, David, you in there? David said, I'm broke. I ain't got nothing to offer, but come on in. We'll face this thing together, is what they were saying. I've got a little hope, and if I got a little hope, I'll share with you what I got. It's dark in here right now, but I promise you, he said, if you'll stick with me and we'll stick with God, we'll come out of this thing and we'll get out of the dark and we'll come into the light. And God is raising up an army today, ladies and gentlemen, that are in a cave. The church is in a cave today. We need to get out of the darkness and come into the light and let Jesus rule and reign in our life.
Amen.
He sent the distressed. Oh, I know how it feels to send the distressed, because the people that came to my rescue were just as distressed as I was. And they didn't know what to do. But they came and got in the darkness with me and began to pray. God set us free. Oh, listen to me. The next one, he said, the Bible says, it sent those that are in debt. He sent those that, why? David is there and he's anointed king. He don't need no money, but he ain't got nothing. But he said he began to send those that were in debt down to the cave. What does that mean? Well, I'm glad you asked. You see, those people were people that were forced to pay taxes that they couldn't afford. They were forced to pay interest rates that they could not afford. There was no way that they could pay the debts that the society had on their life. The government was overtaxing them. They were being destroyed. Their families were being torn apart. And here's the deal, folks. If they didn't pay the debt, you listen to me this morning. If they couldn't pay, their debt couldn't be paid.
Yeah, come on.
Their children would be taken into slavery for the debt that they owed. You say, what does that mean, preacher? You, ladies and gentlemen, have a debt that you can't pay.
That's right.
You couldn't pay it if you made trillions of dollars a year. There's a debt in your life that you could not pay. And if you don't pay it, and you never come to Christ, your children also are going to be a slave to sin, just like you were.
Amen.
They have a choice. So those that are in debt, that have no hope in their life of ever, you see, they couldn't enjoy life. Every move that they made was for King Saul. And he was taking every ounce of strength and courage that they had through taxation. So they come to David, those that were in debt. hoping and praying for a life that was free from oppression. Isn't that, is that not how this country was born? Isn't that exactly what how this country was birthed? Because of religious oppression, because of taxation, we come to America to be free of all that craziness over there. And what do? We turn right around and do the same thing that they did to us over there. We didn't learn nothing, folks. So David, he's letting the distressed in. He's letting the taxed in. What was that next one? What did he say? Those that are in distress, those that are in debt, and everyone that was discontented. Boy, that would fit the whole coffee crew over there. Because they ain't contented about nothing. The only time I get contented over there is when Dennis brings creamer, and that's very, not very often. I just had to slide that in there while I was preaching. Those that are discontented. Folks, I don't know if y'all pay attention to the world around you. Some people have blinders on. They don't pay any attention to the world around them at all. But if you look at people that are paying attention, the world that we live in today is the most discontented people I've ever seen in my life. They're not contented. Well, we'll get in trouble. If you give them $800 a week unemployment to stay at home, they're still discontented. Yeah, yeah. If you give them every avenue in the world to vote, which ain't legal, they're still discontented. If you do all these things that the government tells you to do, they're still discontented. In other words, they don't like society in general. But they know there must be a better life somewhere. A life of contentment and peace. And God sends them down to David at the cave of Adullam to simply find peace in their heart. What am I really saying? I'm saying that sometimes God has to send you to a dark place in your life in order to find the contentment and peace that you need in this life. You say, well, I've never been to a cave. I've never been to a dark place in my life. Have you ever had any trouble in your life? Have you ever had any family problems? Your kids going the wrong way? Your life not turning out right? You got fired from your job? Your rent's due and everything else is due in your life and you can't pay it? Has anybody else besides me ever faced opposition in their life? Listen, it was a dark place and a dark time in my life, but God began to send people that were discontented, people that were in distress, people that were in debt, say, I don't know how we're going to get through this, brother, but we're going to trust God, and we're going to walk on through this thing, and we're going to come out of this victorious. And what God was really doing, folks, he said, when it was all said and done, the people in distress, the people in debt, the people that were discontented. David had an army of 400 soldiers. Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
Oh, they wasn't nothing when they got to the cave. They didn't have no confidence in winning any victories in their life when they got to the cave. But once they got in the cave and they met David and a picture of Christ, who they found loved Jesus more than they loved them. And once they saw David and what he stood for, they rose up as an army of God. Can I tell you this morning that that's exactly the way the church is supposed to be?
That's right.
We're taking those that are in distress. We're taking those that are in debt. We're taking those that are discontented with status quo in the religious world. We're taking them in into our doors. We should be every Sunday night, every Wednesday night. If some wayward soul comes by this place, we ought to let them in our little cave here and show them that there's a God that is our refuge, a God that meets our every need, a God that we can find peace and comfort in the darkest times of our life. That's what church is all about, ladies and gentlemen. It's about coming to the foot of the cross. Oh, the foot of the cross was the darkest place the world had ever seen. When Jesus hung on, it said there was 3 hours of complete darkness. But thanks be to God, it didn't stay dark. It became light on Sunday morning when Jesus came up out of the grave. The light of the world sprang forth, and he's still alive today, sitting at the right hand of the Father.
Amen.
David went to the cave of Adullam, thinking all was lost, thinking nothing could be ever be right again in his life as a young man, knowing that King Saul was going to kill him, he thought. But what did God do? God moved on his behalf, and he started sending him these people that had all these problems in their life. And then God took their souls and he knit them together. That's a perfect picture of the church today. That's what we are. You see, in reality this morning, we're all just a bunch of discontented people in distress. And most of you, if you're like me, you're in debt. Yeah. And God has sent you to this little cave right here to let you find the greatest peace that you'll ever find on this side of eternity. You say, how do I get that? Oh, it's real simple. You simply put your heart and your life in the hands of Jesus and say, Lord, I'm going to trust you. That's what David said in the cave. He said, Lord, you're my refuge. You're my strength. All I need is you, Lord. You don't have to send anybody to my rescue. If I sit in this cave and die, I'm going to die loving you, Jesus. And folks, that's where we need to be today. We need to understand that if God doesn't come to your rescue, he's still God. He's still the Lord. And he'll make a way for you where there is no way. He loves you. He loves you more than you'll ever know. He sends people into your life. You're sitting there this morning as I'm talking about this, and you're thinking through your mind the people that he sent to you when you were in distress, when you were in debt up your eyeballs, when you had no contentment in your life, and you're thinking about the people that he put in your life to bring you out of darkness into the light. Sometimes it takes the death of a loved one to bring somebody to Christ. That's sad, but it's true. As in me, my case, there was an old gentleman by the name of Elvis Noah. He lived right over here on the old McMaster place, right across the parkway. I called him Doc. Doc would come get me from day to day. And we would spend hours and hours driving up to LBL, going fishing, shooting deer, whatever it might be, fishing. It didn't matter. But he invested his time and his life into my life because he knew that I was in distress. He knew that I was discontented. And it wasn't until he got killed right up here on 45 Highway that God brought me to the realization that I was lost and undone. And what he had been trying to accomplish in my life for the last 10 years finally came to realization that I was lost and I needed Jesus. I was coming out of the cave. Oh, I know. I know that old Doc rejoiced the night that God saved me because that had been his heart's desire for years. Listen to me this morning. Some of you have been in a dark place. Some of you have been in a cave. You've lost a loved one. You've lost a family member. You've lost somebody that's dear close to you. You've lost most all anything. And you feel like you have no hope. But listen to this one. Through Jesus Christ, you can find the greatest peace and contentment that you'll ever find on this side of eternity. It's here this morning. Oh, this may be a deep, dark place for you where you're at this morning. But I promise you, according to God's promises, He'll not leave you there. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. He'll walk through that place. He'll walk out of that cave with you. When notice this too. Down there in the next verse, two or three verses down, it said David spoke to the Lord. And the Lord told him to get out of the cave. You read it, it's there. You see, he never came out of that cave until God spoke to him. Neither will you. It takes God's voice sometimes to move us out of the dark place in our life. But the problem is, you see, when you're in a cave, you can't see God. When you're in a cave, you can't hear God. When you're in a cave, you can't feel God. You've lost all sense of anything in your life. When you're in that cave, you lose all those senses. But listen to this one. I serve a God that can reach down into the deepest, darkest cave, and He'll send your help where He sees fit. He'll send those that are in distress. He'll send those that are in debt. He'll send those that are discontented just to heal your soul, to minister to you. That's what those people did. They began to minister to David. And David said, you know what? I've got 400 people in this cave with me besides my family. I've got an army that God has sent. Why am I sitting here in this cave when I've got all this support around me? Let me ask you this morning. Why are you still sitting in your cave of darkness when you've got a surrounding of witnesses around you this morning that'll love you, that'll comfort you, give you contentment, and let you lead you out of that cave and become one of the army with you? That's what God's desire is today, for us to rise up out of the cave. That's what David did. He got up out of the cave and went on to greater and better things. That's what God desires for you today. To get up out of that dark place you were in. And He's got great and mighty things in store for you. Come on, Greg, let's sing. I don't know about you this morning, but as I read that story and I studied that this week, in the two Psalms that he wrote about the cave, I saw a picture of myself at one time in my life when I was in a deep, dark place in my life. And I didn't want to stay there. And God began sending people into my life that would slowly but surely bring me out of the cave. Is there anybody here besides me that's ever felt that? I have. I'm so glad today that God didn't leave me in the cave. Ain't you? Would you stand with me this morning?
Come to the altar.
Are you there this morning? You still looking for the help? You still listening for the voice of God in your cave today? Oh, God's sending you people to rescue right now. He's got people all over this building today that are willing to pray with you. Just stretch out your hand and say, come, take my hand. I need you, Lord. I'll pray for you. Just come. I'll pray with you. Just come. You don't have to stay there today. God has a plan and purpose for your life. He never intended for you to live in the cave. He just took you there for that experience.
No reason to wait. Jesus.
about you this morning. God speak to your heart. You've been in that cave too long. It's time to come out. It's time to let go of the world. Say, God, I need you. I want to serve you to the best of my ability. Lord, I need you to show me the way. I can't see, Lord. It's dark in this cave right here. Would you shine a light of ray of hope in my life so that I can walk out of this place and become victorious in the army of the Lord? Would you come this morning? Is God speaking to your heart today? Do you know Him this morning? Is He your refuge, your tower of strength? All He wants to be. Invite Him into your heart this morning. It'll be the best decision you ever make in your life. What you got?
What is Savior? Isn't He one?
Some are still praying. You've got plenty of time this morning. Get things right with God. Oh, He loves you, God. He wants to do a work in your heart. He wants you to live a life of victory. But you can't live it in the cave. You gotta let Him break you out. Won't you come this morning?
Problem.
That's right.
That's why we call upon him.
Amen.
Lord, it's yours.
Yes.
We agree, but now it's yours.
That's right. When we throw up our hand and say, it's all you, God. Amen. James, you have something?
I just, on behalf of me and Jeremy, I want to thank all the men that participated. Last Monday, at the men's Bible study, we had an awesome meal and a great fellowship. And I love each and every one of you guys.
Amen.
Thank you.
Let me invite you right now. If you've never been to the R6 house at 218 North 6th Street, tomorrow night at 6:30, we're not going to have hamburger and hot dogs. We'll have something better than that.
That's right.
We'll have the Word of God. Come, join us. Worship together. All right. All hearts clear. Everybody out of the table.
Amen.
I hope so. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your power and presence in our life. Lord, I thank you for getting me out of that old cave. Setting me up on a solid rock, Lord. Giving me salvation. Lord, I ask you to bless your people today as they go to their homes. God, bless their homes, their children, all that they have. Continue to bless our church. See souls saved. Thank you, God, for saving Izzy last night. Lord, we just ask you to bless now as we go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.